representative of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Minister Louis Farrakhan.
In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, the One God, to whom all praise is due, the Lord of all the worlds, He who has no associate, no partner, no rival. He's one God from whom all things began and to whom all things must eventually return. We thank Allah for sending Moses and the Torah or Old Testament. We thank Allah for sending us Jesus and the New Testament or the Gospel. We thank Allah for sending us Muhammad and the Holy Quran. Peace. Peace be upon all of these worthy servants of God. But if I lived to be 1,000, I could never thank him enough for raising in our midst a divine leader, teacher, and guide to make the scriptures of the Torah, the Gospel, and the Quran relevant to our struggle for liberation and the struggle of oppressed people all over the earth, and for the total human family to be made into that which God would accept. I thank Allah for the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, my teacher and guide. I can't even start into my subject before I thank Brother Minister Carl. Where's the little dynamite brother? This little big man and the followers of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad of the mosque here in Dallas are responsible for this very beautiful, outstanding, and magnificent representation tonight. Thank you very, very much. May Allah bless you. Thank you. And to the distinguished platform guests, all of you, and to the members of the City Council, who honored me and us with such wonderful citation. On behalf of the Nation of Islam, we thank you from the depth of our heart, and we pray that God will make us worthy of your kind words. To the other Ragsdale sister, is it Charlotte? Where is Charlotte? Charlotte, we thank you so very much for your work with Sister Claudette in making a lot of this possible. And I can't pass this up. This is the Dallas Weekly. If the representative of the Dallas Weekly is here, would you please stand? Thank you so very much. Thank you. Without the black press, we don't have anyone to tell our story. We must support the black press. And of course, the new Final Call newspaper just came out and it's present. It says, Minister Louis Farrakhan calls for reparations for 400 years of servitude the United States government owes black people. To all of you who are here on a Monday night, looking so beautiful. Words are just not adequate to say thank you for standing in line, paying $7, some paying $12 to be searched. And then the minister asked for a collection and you didn't stone him. And Michael Jackson is not singing tonight. This is a great honor to me, and really, Dallas, you're making history tonight. For I don't think there's ever been a black leader or teacher to come to the city of Dallas to draw this amount of people on a Monday night. And what does this show the world? It shows the world that there is a hunger and a thirst in the black community for truth that will set us free. Now, I want to get right to the point tonight. I want to thank the reverend clergy that are present and the politicians who are present, the civic leaders who are present, and all of you. And I just want you to buckle on your seatbelts. There is in America a conspiracy against black males. There is, emanating from the government of the United States, an insidious and wicked plot against the lives of our people. I am here in Dallas not to deliver a speech, for it is Mr. Bush and that kind of person who delivers speeches. Speeches are words put together that sometimes give guidance, solve problems, or aid in some way to clarify some issue. But I am here tonight not to make a speech, but to deliver a word that will save our lives. And that word is rooted in the word of Almighty God, found in the Bible and the Quran. For it is the words of Allah, the words of God, that have the power to transform human life. And our lives are in need of transformation. And so tonight, in the face of a conspiracy, I want to make it clear enough for a baby to understand that we are in trouble. But not only are we in trouble, America is in trouble, and the world is in trouble, and there is no way out for America, for the world, or for us, but to know the time and to act in accord with the time. Now, I'm going to move quickly because this is a highly intelligent-looking audience, and it doesn't need a lot of breaking things down. I'm just going to say things to you, and you talk back to me as I talk to you, and you will let me know if it needs any further elaboration. Now, I'm going to start by reading a verse of the Quran, which is a book that should be on the shelves in the homes of every one of us. It is a wonderful book, and as I teach from this book and from the Bible, the hippest of you will be more hip. The most knowledgeable of you, no matter how many degrees you have, will be even more edified by what you hear tonight of an exegesis of scripture or an interpretation of books that you may have read. This book has been in existence for 1400 years or more. This book has been in existence now for 4,000 years of Moses' revelation, 2,000 years the revelation of Jesus Christ. So here we have old books that have been on our shelves for years, read by scholars, interpreted by so-called wise people. But tonight, one that has no degree. I cannot claim to have letters, but you judge whether I am learned. Tonight, a student of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad will present you with an exegesis of both books that I defy scholars in the world of Islam or Christianity or any other religion to disprove. I'm going to take somebody's time. The scriptures of the Bible say, I thank thee, Father in heaven, for keeping these things from the wise and the prudent man and revealing them unto babes. This is to teach us that wise and prudent people will have pored over the books but will not have seen what God would show to babies. And whether you like it or not, the babies that will expose more truth of divine than has ever been exposed in the history of the world are right here in the United States of America, called Negroes, niggers, coons, colored people, African Americans, or blacks. From us is going to come that guidance that the world needs. Now let us see. Quran, chapter 103, is called Al-Asr, and it is translated the time. It reads like this: in the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, by the time, surely man is in loss, except those who believe and do good and exhort one another to truth and exhort one another to patience. Time. Quran. In the Bible, Ecclesiastes the preacher said, for every purpose under the heaven, there is a season and a time. There is a time to be born, a time to die, a time to laugh, a time to weep, a time to heal, a time to kill, a time to love, a time to hate, a time to gather stones and a time to cast stones away, a time to reap and a time to sow. But for every purpose, not for some purposes, but for every purpose under the heaven, there is a season and a time. By the time, surely man is in loss. Time is the criterion by which we judge the actions of people to be correct or incorrect. If you're in accord with time, your actions bear fruit. If your actions are out of season, they don't bear fruit. The term Asr is considered time, but as Muslims, we have a time of prayer where we make a prayer called Asr. And that prayer takes place when the sun has fallen away from its zenith and is midpoint from the zenith to the time of its setting. Right in that period is called Asr. We are looking at the setting sun of Western civilization. Listen, we are looking at the setting sun of the rule and dominance of the peoples of the earth by Caucasian influence or Eurocentric thought or white supremacist doctrine. Now, since Asr is the time when the sun is not yet set but is setting, then surely man is in loss by the time. If you understand that the sun is setting on white supremacy, as a white person, you have to change your way of thinking or action, or you will not only lose power to rule, but you will lose your life in that which God makes new. Listen, by the time, surely man is in loss. But you, black people, have been the victims of Eurocentric thought and interpretation of scripture and life and life values. Yes, you have been the victims of white supremacy, so you suffer from black inferiority and black dependence on white people to make a future for you.
by the time surely man is in loss. You are losing every day, black brother and sister, because you don't know the time. And your actions are not in accord with the time. For as one day sun is setting in one part of the earth, it is rising in another. Jesus said, I came into the world that those who say they have light may go into darkness. Jesus said, I came into the world that those who are in the darkness may come into the light, for I am the light of the world. But when the light is rising on some, it is setting on others. Are you listening? I came into the world, Jesus said, that those who say they see may become blind. And those who are blind may see. I hasten to say to the people who rule the world, you cannot say you have been in the dark about what the truth is. You have known the truth, but you have not been willing to show the truth to others. So, as the sun is setting on your world, it is now dawning upon us, the despised, the rejected, the unloved, the unwanted. The scripture says, arise and shine, for thy light is come. The people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. Upon them hath the light shine. The time. How do we measure time? To be sure that we are at the time of the end of this world and its system of things. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, time is measured by motion of an object relative to another object. So we have the earth relating to the sun. As the earth moves relative to the light of the sun, responding to the light of the sun, the earth turns on her axis and revolves around the sun, giving us our day and our year, our months, our seasons. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
It's a relationship here. And motion determines time. In the world of God, when God sends his prophets into the world with divine light, we measure time by the prophets and their appearance and their words and understanding of their prophecies. That tells us what time it is in the world's clock. From Adam to Moses was 2,000 years. From Moses to Jesus is 2,000 years. From Jesus to the advent of the second coming, or the coming of the Messiah or the Mahdi, is another 2,000 years. We are at 6,000 years, then we are at the end of the present world's time. 6 days shalt thou labor, but in the seventh day you have to rest. The Sabbath that was given to Israel is to remind you that you only have 6 days. To do your work
But the Sabbath, you got to keep it holy because it is a sign that in the 7,000 year from the making of Adam, a new power would come into the world. And you would cease from your labor of evil. And if you live, you would have to bow to that new power. For in that day, he said he would make all things new. And there would be a new heaven and a new earth, and the former things should pass away. Does it mean? Listen. Does it mean that the heavens are going to be made new and the earth is going to be made new? It could mean that. But that's billions of years away unless Allah pleases to bring it sooner. The sun is dying. And if the sun is dying, this whole solar system will collapse if the sun goes. But Allah said, it's easy for him to reproduce creation. He created it in the first instance so he can reproduce it. Now, white folk, in their tremendous scholarship, have put a telescope in space. They want to get a look, a better look at the universe. This is intelligent. But Allah says in the Quran, that whenever he gets ready to destroy a people, he gives them a peep into the heavens. Now, why is he giving you a peep into the heavens? So you can understand what you're fighting. I mean, Johnny come lately, like you. You have power, but it's not enough. So the more you peep into the vastness of the majesty of the creation of God, shouldn't it make you humble enough to know that you ought to obey him too? And if the awesomeness of space doesn't make your heart humble to the majesty of a creator who could create wonder like this, that has looked down upon fools like us who thought we were powerful, and they have come up and gone down, and the universe still remains. Well, if you understand that we're in the closing hours of the time of this world, then we have to understand what we must do. For if our actions are not proper, we go down with the world when it goes down. But if our actions are proper, we can escape its fall. Surely man is in loss except those who believe. Believe in what? Everybody in here believes in something. But it's not just what you believe in your personal way. God is going to send some truth into the world that is very deep and profound, yet simple. And if you believe in it and act on its principles, that is doing good. See, doing good, you can lead an old lady across the street. That's good. You can help somebody with their bags. That's good. You can loan somebody that needs something some money. That's good. But that's not the good that the book is talking about. That's good. But the good that will get us out of this condition is not bad. The good that is getting us out of this condition, white and black, is bowing to the will of God as expressed through his prophets, articulated. you can save your life. Now, black folk are killing each other today in unprecedented numbers. Something has gone wrong with us. Even 30, 40, 50 years ago, under segregation, lynching, and the worst kind of treatment by white people, we never killed each other like we are doing today. Now, we can get angry with Caucasian people and say what they did to us. Yes. And sometimes we get caught up in that, what they did to us. But we can stop what they did and what they're doing if we put a stop to what we're doing to hurt ourselves and one another. We have become our worst enemy. When a white policeman shoots down a black youth in Dallas, we scream about it, don't we? We protest, don't we? But every Friday, Saturday, and Sunday night at the local hospitals, you ought to see the emergency room and see how many of us we are sending to an untimely death, but there's no protest. I'm appealing to the religious leaders and to the political and civic leaders and to all of us that it is worse when we kill ourselves than when they kill us, because they have been killing us all along. But now we are programmed to finish the job that their fathers started. And it is deprogramming us and reprogramming us that we will be healers instead of killers, saviors instead of destroyers. This is why I'm in Dallas tonight. This is why I'm going throughout America, because we are playing into the hands of our enemies. We are allowing our ignorance to be manipulated by those forces that don't like us or love us at all. The Bible says, my people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. We are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. But again, the scripture says, how can they know except they have a teacher? And how can they have a teacher except he be sent? And white folks are not going to send us a teacher to save us from them. Most of you leaders are prepared by them. And this is why you are powerless to save yourself or them. Most of you preachers are prepared by them. And that's why you can't save yourself or them. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said to me that if a man will not treat you right, that man will not teach you right. over 400 years, then it is clear that we have not been taught right for 400 years, and that's why we have to be retaught, retrained, re-educated.
Yes, sir.
All praise is due to Allah. There's a time to be born and a time to die. When both things come at the same time, that's a tough time. When there's a time to love and a time to hate, and both things happen at the same time. When there's a time to gather stones and throw stones away, and both things happen at the same time, you're in a very special, a very unique time. When Jesus came, he said, according to the scripture, "Think not that I came into the world to bring peace, nay, a sword." Come on, Reverend. Jesus said, "I came to set the mother-in-law at variance with the daughter-in-law, the son-in-law at variance with the father-in-law." Why, Jesus? "Two will be grinding at the mill, I'll take one and leave one. Two will be laying in the bed, I'll take one and leave one. I'm coming to separate the people. I didn't come to unify them. I came to separate them." Unity with hypocrites is not valid. Unity with devils is not acceptable. Unity with the evildoer is not acceptable. So I want those who want righteousness to be in unity, and those who choose evil to also be in unity. Then I will bring a clash about between the right and the wrong, the wicked and the righteous, and I will be on the side of the righteous, and wickedness will be destroyed from the face of the earth. This is the time that we're living in. The armies are gathering all over the earth. The Pope is saying peace. The President says peace. Gorbachev wants peace. But the Bible says no peace for the wicked. There'll be no peace for the wicked. I know what you're saying. But the Bible says, let us beat our swords and our spears into plowshares and pruning hooks and study war no more. Go back and read it again. Go back and read it again. It reads first, wake up the mighty men of war. Wake up the mighty men of war and tell them to take their spears and their pruning hooks and their artifacts of cultivation and turn them into instruments of war. Why? I'm going to gather all nations down into the valley of Jehoshaphat. And there will I plead with them for my people whom they have sold for wine that they may drink. I'm going to gather all the nations into a valley for war. And now small nations, large nations, are spending their resources going into debt, not buying pruning hooks,
and plowshare, they're buying the weapons of war. For what? Because war is on the horizon. Death and destruction are on the horizon. You're not going to get away from it. We're living in the time of the end of the white man's world, and he's not going out without a fight.
Now look, I know this is hurting. It don't make me happy to say it, but I have to tell it. Because if I don't tell it, I'll get chastised by God. And I fear him more than I fear all the guns that don't like me. I have got to tell it, whether you hear it or reject it. That's not up to me. I just have to deliver the message. Now watch what we're saying. The war clouds are gathering over the whole earth. Gorbachev and Mr. Bush met in Malta. We don't know what they said. But they came out kind of smiling. But Mr. Reagan told us that Russia was the focus of evil in the world and was an evil empire. But he sat down with Gorbachev. Now Bush sat down with Gorbachev, and now they're friends. What's being planned? How will it affect third world people? We can surmise what they're planning. We can assume, although assumptions are not necessarily true. But if we study the historical pattern of these persons, then we are justified in drawing certain conclusions or coming to certain assumptions. Mr. Gorbachev publicly asked Mr. Bush, "I'm having a problem. Don't meddle in my problem." And Mr. Bush said, Mr. Gorbachev asked that we not interfere in their internal problem. He didn't say what he asked Mr. Gorbachev. But let's assume, because I did assume and spoke my assumption, and they came out right on target. I said, Mr. Bush wants the Western Hemisphere. He was going after Panama. I said it in October in a press conference, that their first order of business is to attack Panama. 2 months later, December, while the people of Panama were preparing for Christmas, Mr. Bush brought out the stealth bomber that he had never tested in any theater of operation to test it on the people of Panama under the guise of, we're getting rid of a drug-running dictator. You must never forget that Mr. Bush was once head of the CIA, a drug-running, killing outfit. You must never forget that.
And Mr. Bush should be very careful, because chickens do have a way of coming home to roost. We said in our press conference that as soon as he moved on Panama, he was going to move on Nicaragua and Daniel Ortega. And what he did was very clever. Through his functionaries, he got Mr. Ortega to agree, since he wanted a relationship with Washington, he wanted Ortega to agree to have an election. Knowing all the time that he has hurt Noriega economically. I'm sorry, he hurt Ortega economically. He hurt Panama economically. He wants Noriega out. He wants Ortega out. The first thing he does, make it hard for the people to survive on the inside of the country by sending the Contras to destroy installations that are good for the people. Water, electricity, farm project, so that the people have so much internal problems that once he submits to democracy, thinking that he's very popular, he's sure he will win because he's popular. But the moment he accepted that, and Violeta Chamorro was set up to run against him, millions of the taxpayers' dollars were sent into Nicaragua to buy an election. And people voted for their stomachs, even though their heart is with Daniel Ortega. They figured they needed a change. So now, Mrs. Chamorro and the new leaders in Panama, who are white, the indigenous Ortega and Noriega, who were indigenous, dark people, overthrown, and a white government now in power in Panama, and a white government mainly in power in Nicaragua. Now, after bombing Panama, they put Colin Powell, a black man, out in front to apologize for America's action when he was not even involved in the planning of the operation. You better listen, black brothers and sisters. He deceived Ortega. And now they're asking for over $500 million between Panama and Nicaragua, and the Senate is reneging. Trouble brewing. He said he's got his eye on Cuba. In my press conference, I said, Cuba is third. And then I said, they will use American troops in the third world, particularly against Marxist regimes in Africa. Now that Mr. Bush and Mr. Gorbachev have embraced each other, they say there's no more threat of war in Eastern Europe, so they are looking for the use of troops now in the third world. I ask Mr. Bush, come on. What do you think we are? These are our people in Panama. These are our people in Nicaragua. These are our people in Cuba. These are our people in Angola and in Mozambique. And these were our people in Grenada. You are being set up to be used against the rise of your people all over the world. They have 5.6% unemployment nationally. But what is your unemployment rate? In some cities, it is 40%, 30%, 50%, and among our youth, it is 50 to 70% of our young people don't have any jobs. Look at the city of Dallas. You got about 1,500 black businesses in Dallas, most of them of the service kind, small businesses. And until Coma Cottrell brought Proline to Dallas, you didn't have a major hire of black people. But when Proline came, 300 or more jobs were opened up for black people. But when Dallas went bust over the oil crisis, then turn around and look at the new buildings in Dallas. They're office buildings, new hotels, service-oriented businesses that skilled people may have a chance to have. But since most of you are unskilled, what has happened to the factories in Dallas? The factories in Boston, in New York, in Chicago, in Cleveland, Detroit, LA, in Memphis, Tennessee, all of the factories are moving out of the inner cities, moving into the suburbs, or moving out of America into third world countries, leaving the inner cities of America like dead zones. Listen to me. Bear with me. The Kerner Commission in 1968, set up by Lyndon Johnson, made a study. And they came back to the president and presented their findings, and they said, America is drifting toward two societies, one black, one white, separate and unequal. Farrakhan didn't say it. The Kerner Commission said it. The Kerner Commission advised the president, look, there are 12 and a half million black people in the inner cities of America. If you want to mainstream black people, America has to have the will to tax herself, because it's going to take the commitment of billions of dollars to mainstream black people so that the inner cities will be livable. They said that by 1985, if nothing were done, there would be 21 and a half million black people in the inner cities of America. And then it would be impossible to integrate them or mainstream them. They said that to Lyndon Johnson in 68. Martin Luther King was murdered in 68 because Martin Luther King Jr. didn't have a dream. Martin Luther King Jr. was facing some reality. And that reality was that America could not prosecute a war in Southeast Asia, spending billions of dollars there, killing off poor people, peasants, and leave poor people in the cities of America hungering, thirsting for justice. When Martin King stood up against the war in Vietnam, he was assassinated. And you know and I know that the government of the United States of America had a hand in it. You can't pacify us by naming streets after our brother and giving us a holiday. We would much rather have our brother than to have streets named after him after you kill him. Malcolm X would be alive today if the government of the United States had not worked night and day to separate Malcolm X from his teacher, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and then to create that kind of division, foment the disorder, create the atmosphere into which Malcolm could be assassinated. Yes, he was assassinated by black people, but who was the paymaster? Sounds somewhat political, but I'm bringing you actual facts. In 1983, in the Washington Post, in an article written by Mr. William Raspberry, a black man, he said that a think tank of white professionals had said to white businesses, do not invest in the inner cities of America because they are social tinderboxes. So business was instructed not to invest in the inner cities. So now, here we are in 1990. There are over 21.5 million black people in the inner cities. We have 500 black mayors presiding over declining affairs. 500 black mayors presiding over a tax base that is either not there or shrinking. 500 black mayors who are being put into office to prove that black folk can't govern. 500 black mayors that are nothing more than managers of affairs according to their dictates. 500 black mayors that may mean good for us, but can't do good for us because they don't have control. We have over 6,000 black men and women in some political office. Most of them don't belong to us. I have to tell the truth. I have to tell the truth. Most of our black elected officials are bought and paid for by outside interests that don't give a doggone about our community. That's not our black political leaders' fault. That's our fault. We send our people into the state legislatures and the city councils, but we don't make them accountable to us. and therefore they submit more to the demands of others. When we get a little smile from white people and they invite us to parties in their homes and we can sip tea or champagne on their lawn, all of a sudden we forget what our mission is, what our objective is, what our cause is. Our preachers are not our own. Many of our preachers are professional preachers. They don't care nothing about saving black people, but they have congregation full of black people. They don't care nothing about making black people better. They preach for money. They preach for favor with the enemy of our people. Our people going under. Our leaders bought off. Our teachers afraid to teach. Our preachers afraid to preach. Our young people run amok. Gangs rising up, killing each other with Uzis and AK-47s and street sweepers brought into our community by our enemies. Now, crack cocaine, drugs in our community. Our young girls turned out, made prostitutes at 14. Some mothers are on crack, and they pay the crack dealer with their 14 and 13-year-old daughters. We've gone so low that fathers are taking off their virgin daughters. Uncles taking off their virgin nieces and nephews. We've become a sick people, a degenerate people. Cadillac driving, Mercedes-Benz driving, Gucci bag wearing, alligator shoe wearing degenerates. Who will help us? Who will guide us? Who will teach us to save ourselves? Who will help us to understand what is going on that we may make a change in our life? No jobs for the black man. These young black men, they don't want to run out on their wives and their children. Some black men are irresponsible, but not all. These young black men, how do you think they feel when their wife has a need and they can't meet it? And their children ask for shoes and they can't get it. So with the economic depression, more and more black homes are headed by a female. Where's the male who made that woman pregnant? That male is gone. So our women are here with the burden of children, nobody to love them,
nobody to really care for them. So they become hostile and bitter and teach their children to hate their own fathers. So we are a community now feeding on ourselves. There are 60,000 excess deaths in the black community each and every year. We're dying in tremendous numbers.
Yes, sir.
Stroke, hypertension, cirrhosis of the liver, drugs. But there's another thing that's killing us. To live in the white man's world, seeing his world being built up all around us, and we help the man build his world. And we can't be what God created us to be because we don't have the knowledge and we don't have the substance. So there's an extraordinary amount of stress on the black male. An extraordinary amount of stress on the black female. So when we meet each other, just one word out of place, and we have all flared up, and the black man is living in the black woman's mouth like a dentist. Go to the city jails, and if the statistics are the same in Dallas as they are in some of the major cities. 85% and 90% of the inmates of the city jails in the male population are black, and 85% to 95% of the females in the city jails are black. We're not criminals, but we are the victims of a criminal society. How are we going to stop the killing? And if time has said that we've got to love and hate, be born and die, reap and sow, gather stones and cast stones away at the same time, what hour are we in? The Bible says, before the great and dreadful day of the Lord, I will send you Elijah. The day is great and dreadful at the same time. It's a heck of a time. So you gotta die in the old mind of a Negro and be born again in the new mind of a new creation of God. So you gotta die and come to birth at the same time. You gotta love the new man and woman that God wants to make you, and you gotta hate the man and woman that the world of the white man has made you. You gotta love and hate at the same time. You gotta die and be born at the same time. You gotta gather new stones and cast the old stones away at the same time. My dear brothers and sisters, thank you. With your kind permission, I'd like to delve deeper now. We have lost respect for life. Life is the most precious gift of God to his creatures. And yet we can snuff out another human being's life without giving it a thought as to the seriousness of what we are doing. Death pervades our minds. Why did it happen? How did it happen? Remember, for every purpose, there's a season and a time for everything under the heavens. Did you know that there's a purpose for evil? And there's a time. And there's a purpose for death. And there's a time. You say, you mean that death has a time to end? Yes. Not the physical act of dying. Dear reverends and dear imams, Muslims, we cannot talk about resurrection unless we speak of resurrection in the context of death. If you don't know how we died, then you won't know how we are to be raised. And to speak of resurrection of human beings outside of the context of that death that made resurrection necessary, you are not preaching the scriptures properly or with the degree of intelligence that we could. Scripture is not hard to understand. It's so easy when it is rightly explained, and once you see it, it just unleashes tremendous power when you understand. And that's why Solomon says, get wisdom, it's the principal thing. But with all thy getting, get understanding. I'm gonna take this mic so I can walk a little bit. Because I want it. Can you hear me all right? Brothers and sisters, the scripture says, all in Adam die. How did Adam die? The scripture says that when God created Adam, he told Adam, eat of all the trees in the garden, except this one, in the center of the garden, in the middle of the garden. He said, the day you eat the fruit of this tree, you shall surely die. God walks away after he makes Eve to help Adam. Now, that's very interesting. God made the woman, according to the book, to help the man. Help you do what? And I must say to our pastors that the reason you have churches filled with women and not men is because you're not representing a certain aspect of the gospel that appeals to men. And listen, just listen. Y'all all right? Hang with me just a few minutes. In the beginning, when God created man, the scripture said he gave man, number one, power. Number two, dominion over the fowl of the air, the fish of the sea, and every creeping thing that crawls upon the earth. And he gave man an order
to multiply, replenish the earth, and subdue it. Bring it under your power. I'm giving you orders. I'm giving you an assignment. I'm giving you a job. And then I'm giving you a woman to help you. And the scripture called her a help meet. M-E-E-T. Now, when two things meet, they join together. Expectation, hope, fulfillment, they meet. Joy. If a woman is to help a man meet what? Meet your obligation to God. If your duty is to get power and dominion, to multiply, replenish the earth, subdue it, become its master, then a woman is here to help you be its master. Listen, but a woman can't help you do nothing.
Uh-oh.
A man don't need a woman to do nothing. When a man is going no place, got nothing to do, has no vision, no aim, no purpose, you don't need a woman. Because all you can do then is mess over a woman. A woman wants to help you go somewhere, do something, meet your goal. Am I right, sisters? All right. Now, when I talk to the sisters, if I'm telling it right, let the brothers know that I'm saying it right. See? Because as men, if we know how to keep a woman happy, we can keep our home together. But you can't keep a woman happy with the bed. You can keep a woman happy by the proper use of knowledge. No man has to beat a woman. Not a man. Not a man. No man should beat a woman. No man should beat a woman. If you know what to do with a woman by knowing what to do with yourself, then you won't have to beat a woman. She'll be right there for you, right there with you. Am I right, sisters? Listen, all praise is due to Allah. All right, let's go a little deeper. Everybody all right? Now look. After Adam went to work, Eve went to helping him, God left the garden, here come a snake. Now, if it were a real snake, sister, you wouldn't be there talking. You just don't talk to snakes. But this snake was talking, and he was evidently making sense. Because he said to Eve, look here, baby. He said, Eve, so you see, God didn't really mean that if you ate the fruit, you would die. He didn't really mean it. He meant, you see, that your eyes would come open. See, God don't want you to be like him. Rule with the same power that he rules with. And that's why he's keeping you from something. But the moment you eat this fruit, you're not going to die. Your eyes are going to come open. Now here you got
two powers. One power telling Adam, look, don't eat this. The day you eat it, you will surely die. Another power saying, don't believe that. Don't believe the hype. If he tells you don't eat that fruit, you eat it and your eyes are gonna come open. And check this out. She ate the fruit. She gives it to Adam. He eats it. Did he die? He didn't drop dead. He was still talking. Adam, eyes sure enough came open. And he looked down and said, I ain't got no clothes on. Hey, baby, get me a fig. Get me a leaf. Get me something. Round about that time, he hears some footsteps. You know he ain't dead. He's hearing. He hears God walking in the garden. He gets shook up. He said, uh-oh. He feels guilty. God said, did not I tell you not to eat the fruit? He said, yeah, but, you know, he made his excuses like we always do. He said, I'm naked. He said, how did you know? Now, what does this mean? We've all read it. Adam did die. At the same moment that his eyes came open, he died. What is death? Look, the wages of sin is what? According to the book. What is sin? Paul says it's transgression of the law. What is life? Life is obedience to the Creator who gives everything its being, its existence, its way. So when you obey the Creator, you are alive spiritually, mentally, morally. When you begin to disobey the Creator, you begin to transgress, and the wages of that sin is the death of your spiritual power. Listen, listen, listen. When he disobeyed, the book says Adam fell. The Quran says he slipped. He fell. What did he fall from? A stone, a rock? No. He fell from the high place that God has for man. Both the Quran and the Bible say that man is God's vicegerent. Man rules in God's place by God's permission. Man is to exercise power as the glory of God. But when man rebels against God, at that moment his eyes came open to a lower nature, to the power of a lower self. From the navel down is the underworld of man. You didn't hear me. I want you to listen now, because we're coming up out of this death. This is the appetites. And this is what makes you either a human being or an animal. How you control the appetites. If the appetites control you, then you have died here and are buried under the flesh. Since the flesh comes from the earth,
When the mind rebels against God, then you die, and the real you is buried in and under the flesh of you. So the real power of you is not seen anymore. It is dead and buried under the flesh and the appetites of the flesh. Do you hear me? Now let's prove our point. The world of appetites is called the carnal mind and the flesh lusts. When you have greed for power, greed for dominance over your brother, lust to raise your people in an inordinate kind of way, drunk over some special characteristic that you think is yours by race or ethnic origin or by education or birth. When you begin to think that these things make you better than others, you are dead in the flesh of yourself. Listen. When a white man says, I'm better because I'm white, not because I'm right, but because I'm white, you're dead, buried under the flesh. The spirit can't survive, because the moment you think you're better because you're white, then you think you're privileged because you're white. Then you feel yourself above the law and the law unto yourself. So while others have to obey you and your law, you have to obey nobody, because after all, you're white and you're privileged. This makes you sick, and this makes you a beast in human form. You got it? You got it. Once you become a beast in human form, you are driven by the force of death. The mind that is in rebellion to God is a mind that is riding you to death. And I saw a pale horse. And on that pale horse, he had a rider. And the rider was death. And hell followed closely behind. Didn't say I saw a white horse. I saw a pale horse. The rider was death. To the Caucasian people in our audience, listen to me. And don't accuse me of being a racist, because I don't believe in that foolishness. I don't believe in that. I'm not here to castigate one race to exalt another. That's not what I'm about. But unless we can face the truth, we're in trouble. The white race has ruled the peoples of the earth not with justice. Come on. You're the ruler, but you have not ruled anywhere with justice. Well, if you don't rule with justice, then your rule is not righteous. If your rule is not righteous, it is not in harmony with the will of God. If your rule is not in harmony with the will of God, it is not a good rule. And that's why Jesus made a parable of the wicked husbandmen. That the earth was let out into the hands of some wicked husbandmen. And he sent people in to check the fruits, and the fruits were not coming out right. Then he sent the air in, and they killed the air. And Jesus asked, what will the owner of the vineyard do when he comes? And the answer is, he will utterly slay them. He's talking to the Jews. Now, your rule, white people, has been a rule of death. You have been like snow over the earth, freezing the life
in the seeds that are under your rule. That's why nobody manifests their real true nature and quality under your rule. Your rule, your education, your politics, your religion is all bent out of shape with a Eurocentric white supremacist view, and that is death. Death not only to us, but it's death to yourself. And this is why Masons, Shriners, you can only get 33 degrees of knowledge. Water freezes at 32. So the rule of this world is by the Masons and the Shriners. And if you only got 32 degrees of knowledge, you are frozen. And you freeze everything under you. You never let people under you come into the light because you hold the secret to yourself like ice holds water to itself. Killers of the human being. Do you hear what I'm saying? Those in the light, you understand what I'm saying. Your rule is death. A horse is the most intelligent of all the beasts. But it had a rider, and the rider was death. You are the greatest of God's creation. But who's riding you?
Hi.
Who's your rider? You know how we can tell who your rider is? All we gotta see is what's falling behind you. If hell is falling behind you, we know that death is your rider. Now, do you have hell in your house? Talk to me. Do you have hell in the schools? Is there hell in the churches? Is there hell in the society? Well, then who's the rider? Death. Death is in City Hall. Death is in the state capitol. Death is in the White House. Why? Because the rulers are not in obedience to the will and the law of God. They are ruling contrary to the law of God and the law of justice. And so I saw a black horse. I saw a black horse. And its rider had a scale in his hand. The scale represents justice. And only when your mind is balanced with justice can you ride this body right. Ride it on to victory. But as long as death is your rider, then hell is following closely behind. I want us, by the grace of God, to stop the killing. Stop the killing. You can't stop the killing until you remove death as being the rider of your mind. You're ruled by white supremacy. Sorry about that. The church is dominated by white supremacy. And you may not like this, but even in the mosque, in Islam, white supremacy in Islam. I know what Muslims say. There is no such thing as color in Islam. You tell that to some other fool. You don't tell that to me. In principle, that's right. But in practice, that's not the case. You know it, and I know it. The germ of racism has poisoned the bloodstream of every religion on the earth. Death rides. Now, sisters, death is riding you. You are a good woman by nature,
but you got the wrong rider. It's bad, isn't it, to see young people kill each other? How many mothers are going to bed tonight grieving over a young child that was killed in a drive-by killing by some other young person? Many young mothers in California just grieving themselves to death over their children. Aren't you? But you're not grieving over the killing of the unborn child. You know why? Death is the rider. And look at the excuses we make for abortion. See, it's the same excuse that a criminal makes when you don't want to be caught. You're robbing a bank. And the teller sees your face. You don't want to be discovered, so you pop him. And you justify it by saying, if he saw me, I'd have to go before the courts. I'd do time, and it's better to kill him than for him to finger me. And therefore, I feel justified. I popped him. Now, look at what you say to yourself. Oh, I'm not ready for this baby. I told my mother I was just going to the prom and I'd be right back. And now I'm pregnant. Oh, God, what will my mother think? Oh, what will my father think? Ah. Oh. I better cover this crime up. I'm going to the abortion clinic. See, the government makes it very easy, very legal, very right. They want us to be respectful of our parents, but then they say that the children can have abortions and they don't even have to tell their parents. This is cold stuff. So we have abortions and we flush human life down the tube. Now wait, sisters. This is not to make you feel guilty. I'm not here to inflict pain on you. But I want you to understand what we're doing. And then after tonight, don't do it anymore. God will forgive you for what we do in ignorance. So yes, you're forgiven for the past. Just don't do it anymore after you know. Look, you have the right of choice. You have the right to choose the man that you're going to sleep with. Make an intelligent decision. You have the right of choice. You have the right to choose to be disciplined over undisciplined, to be principled over unprincipled, to be moral over being immoral. You do have the right of choice. But when you have made your choice to lay down, then God does not give you the right to choose to kill life. Because the life that you kill may be the very savior that you're looking for. Please let me tell you this. My mother met my father in a day of love. He was a brown-skinned, handsome man. My mother was real, real dark, but real pretty. Go ahead. She met this man, and she never got pregnant. He was a philanderer. He ran around. She got tired of it. She let the dude go. Married my brother's father. Had a child, which is my older brother. Somehow, that first love slipped back into the picture. And mama conceived, and it was me.
And look, what an embarrassment. Oh, God, she was in trouble. So she took a hanger and tried three times to get rid of me. And God would not let it happen. And because after the third time, he wouldn't let it happen, she said, I'll go on and have the child. Now, here I am. I came under unfortunate circumstances, but I'm here now. I thank God that my mother failed in her attempt, but another hand was over her hand, because I was born to be a child of destiny for the rise of black people, but for the rise of human beings all over the earth. And so out of a negative circumstance came a positive result. And I'm saying to you, mothers, Mary, the mother of Jesus, became pregnant in a strange way, in a strange time. The law was that any woman found pregnant without marriage, meaning she fornicated, was to be stoned to death. Mary had every right to have an abortion. But suppose she thought like us, oh, my God, I'm facing, they'll stone me to death. But the angel of the Lord said, that which you're carrying in your womb is to be a mercy to the nation. And she was hidden away privily to escape the wrath of the ruling powers of her day. And she brought forth a child, a male child. And the government was trying to kill the child before the child was born. And I'm suggesting to you that we are bringing forth babies today, those that come forth, watch those babies, because they are precious. You don't know what you're carrying. Mother that is pregnant tonight, don't get rid of it. Hold on. And even though you feel it may be painful, I'm telling you, that you're carrying is a blessing to you, as well as to your people, as well as to the world. You know what time it is? He said he would pour out his spirit without number at a certain time, and you'd see the old prophets walking around again. It don't mean that Abraham is walking, or Moses, or David, or Joshua in their physical flesh, but they're walking today. Meaning that the mind of Abraham, the mind of Moses, the mind of Daniel, the mind of the prophets is now coming to birth in insignificant little children. The mind of Hannibal, the mind of Toussaint Louverture, the mind of the great generals of the past, they're coming to birth now in you. You must not kill the fruit of your womb. And if you have, lift up your head. And like Jesus, when they brought the woman to him that was found in adultery, they never brought the man. They just brought her. Jesus, we found her. The law says stone her. They had the stones already in the hand. Jesus bent down and wrote in the sand, he that is without sin, let him cast the first stone. And then, as the would-be stoners retreated, Jesus went to the woman. He said, woman, where are your accusers? And listen to his words. Neither do I accuse you. Go.
and sin no more. Isn't that beautiful?
And so, now we offer some solutions and we can go home. The death of our mind is not permanent. When truth comes,
we will be raised to life.
Resurrection comes in the form of a flesh and blood human being, a man in whom God deposits the power of truth that will raise you from the dead. That man says, I am the resurrection and the life. If you believe in me, though you are dead, yet shall you live.
This is not talking about somebody in no cemetery. It's talking about a man that will bring a specific truth, and that truth is not aimed at your mind and heart. It is aimed at the nature of you. And when it strikes your nature, you know it all on the inside. And if you believe from that moment on, the process of your rising again starts to take place. Now, brothers, sisters, you know we are at odds with each other, men and women. And we're really at odds with each other because we don't understand our nature. And we are dead in the nature in which God created us. Black man, you are really born of the righteous, but you're not right. You're dead in the nature of yourself. The woman is born of the righteous, but you're dead in the nature of yourself. Your mind is down in your body, buried. So you think more of your breast and your hips and your waist and your legs and your hair and your physical beauty than you think of your mind and your spirit and the real power of you as a woman. Right?
Dead. Brother, muscle bound.
But living inside your body, thinking that your muscle is king, your ability to be a great basketball player is king, a great singer, a great fighter, but you can't hold on to your woman with all your muscles. You can't hold her tight enough to keep her. Ain't that something?
Strong muscle, but can't hold a woman tight enough to keep her.
Because you never hold a woman with your arms. You hold her with the arm of knowledge.
And as long as you don't have knowledge to hold her, your arms are never strong enough to hold your woman. She's not an adulteress by nature. Let me tell you something about the nature of a woman, as was taught to me by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Do you know when a woman loves a man, really loves him, no other man can get to her. No other man can get to her.
Am I right, sisters? When your heart is full of a man, I don't care if the most handsome man that ever lived came by and said, hey, baby, you'll frown on that man if he's trying to get to you and take you from the man you love. Talk to me. Am I right? Is that right?
Okay. Listen to this, brothers. If that's right, you got to learn how to fill a woman's heart up with you.
If you don't want her looking at nobody else, fill her cup with you. If your cup is filled with you, can nobody put nothing in it? Already full. Huh? Okay, y'all all right? What will cause a man to fill her cup? Brothers, the Holy Quran is a key to the nature of things. There's not a man in here who can't make his wife happy completely. Every man that you're married to, even if you're dissatisfied with it, he has the potential to make you supremely happy, sister. And you can look all you want over his shoulder. You're just finding more trouble to get into. Because the same thing that's wrong with your husband is wrong with the other one's husband. So you better hold on to what you got. Everybody all right? Now, men, we want our woman's heart filled with us. Is that right? Listen to what the Quran says. In the fourth chapter, Allah says, serve, O people, keep your duty to Allah, your guardian Lord, by whom you demand of each other your rights. Women have a nature that makes a demand on our nature. And we got a nature that makes a demand on her nature. And the way God created man and woman is that in this demand, it is embodied in a duty. A duty is something we are obligated to perform. And in the performance of that duty, we get certain rewards. In the dereliction of that duty, we get certain punishment. Now, your nature as a female demands on my nature as a man. My nature demands something from you. But since I am created first, then I have the first obligation to keep my duty to you in order for you to keep your duty to me and us. Are you listening, brothers? You can't talk about my wife is running with some other man. Wait a minute. Where did we go wrong? In our duty to her. Uh-huh. Well, just a minute, Farrakhan. What is our duty? Our duty is, as the Quran teaches, to be the maintainers of women. Now, the modern woman, the modern woman says, I don't need a man for nothing. The modern woman says, you can't do nothing for me, honey. But it's not quite true. You got money. You got a nice job. Some of you professional women, doctors, lawyers, teachers, but you're miserable, aren't you? You're professional, you're independent, you got money, you got a car, but you got a lot of hell, a lot of misery. You know why? Because there is no compensation in your professional life for the way God made us to relate to each other. I'm almost finished. woman is to be maintained by man. What does maintenance mean? You got a house, an apartment, things go wrong in the best. You got to keep watching your house in order to see what your house needs. A good husbandman watches the plant to see what's biting on it, what's eating it, what's afflicting it, and takes care of business. Then the plant grows beautifully, magnificently. God created the woman to depend on the nature of the man. And God created man to depend on the nature of God. God feed man feed woman. God maintain man maintain woman. That's the circle. That circle has been broken. Men around here worshiping the woman. Wrong, brother. Wrong, brother. Wrong, brother. I used to sing. I think it's the most foolish thing to say to a woman, I can't live without you, baby. Don't tell a woman that. Because that's not true. If she died, you're not jumping in the grave with her. You try to hang on, don't you? You can live without him, can't you? Because he wasn't in the womb with you when you were there farming by yourself. You and God. So if you, he was not in the womb with you, but God was in the womb, you can't live without God, but you can live without him, and he can live without you. Is that right? Uh-huh. But when you worship a woman, oh, baby, I just love you so much, baby. I don't know what to do without you, baby. Oh, baby, don't leave me, baby, don't leave me. Man, she look at you and said, it's punk. She wants somebody to stand up. She wants somebody to lean on. She wants somebody that's a rock for her to stand on that's solid, brother. She wants somebody to counsel her. To give her wisdom and guidance in situations. She'll help you too with wisdom and guidance in situations. But she wants to know she got a man that she can look up to because he can think, he can plan, he can formulate, he can move things. All praise is due to Allah. Unfortunately, the man has been robbed of the knowledge of how to maintain his woman or himself. So he's making a demand on you and you making a demand on him, he ain't fulfilling it. So you're very unhappy. You demand him to upkeep you and you bent out of shape. Insecure emotionally, financially, physically, and when you make the demand, he ain't coming through. And then at night, you see, when he comes home, hi, baby. Well, and she ain't smiling then. She get way over in the corner of the bed. Don't touch me. Any resemblance or any person's living or dead ain't no coincidence at all, brother. This is your life. She don't want to be bothered with you if you ain't taking care of no business. You say, baby, what's the matter with you? You real cold. She wanna tell you,
look, man.
She ain't got no spirit to console you, to comfort you, to love you. You ain't doing nothing to be worthy of it. And that's why the men don't understand. So they say, hey, what's the matter with you? Well, you don't want me? To hell with you. Get on up. Next thing you know, you see him in San Francisco. By the bay, honey. It's terrible. I don't mean to be funny, but we can't cope with our women. We can't handle our women. So many of us are becoming other than ourselves to get out of the struggle. And the sisters now getting real crazy. I just hate men. That's what, I just hate them. They're all no good. That's a bunch of dogs. So the women are going with each other. But you're not a lesbian. You're just having a lesbian experience. You're not a sissy, brother. You're just having a sissy experience. But when a real man come along, he'll pull the sissy and make him a man. And when a real man come along, you don't want no woman no more, baby. When a real man come along, you'll act like a woman again. And God said, let us make man. We got to make a man all over again. Now, the woman's nature, according to the Quran, is to console the man and give him peace and quiet of mind. That's what gives a man strength to go out and conquer a world when he knows he got a woman. And when he comes home to her, she can console him. Just her person consoles him. Her cooking consoles him. And other things console him. And I don't care how professional you are, sister. You need a man to console. And when the real man comes along, he don't have to ask you to do nothing for him. You say to him, baby, I know it's been hard today. Honey, come on in and just relax yourself, darling. He said, what's that cooking? He said, it's what's in the pot. Yes. And it used to be like that until it got crazy. A woman, when she loves purely. She gives herself completely. And that's why there's no such thing as a no good woman. Every no good woman was made no good by an experience with a no good man. That's a fact, brother. Now, look. In order to stop the killing, I have to say to the black man, we got to wake up the nature of the black man, Reverend. He's a good man, but we got to wake up his nature. 90% of the problem will be solved when you wake up his nature. Because see, the nature of man is the nature of God. And God is not a beggar. He don't go around asking, you got a job for me? God create a job. God create worlds. So if we wake up in our nature, we come together as a people, pool our resources educationally and financially, and we'll create a job for ourselves and for our people. We ain't got to beg the white man for nothing. Is that right? All right, listen. But brothers, we have to wake up the nature in the woman. And you gotta stop killing the woman. Many of you women in this audience tonight are literally dead in the nature of you as a woman because of a bad experience you had with a man. And unfortunately, if that man is your father, that's pretty rough. And this is going on in our community, and nobody talks about it. The women are afraid to say it, so I just have to speak for you. But when a father can't understand the pure love of his own daughter, and when his wife is asleep, he slips into her room at night and forces himself on his own daughter. She doesn't know how to tell her father, stop. This is her father. So she begins to feel very terrible. She wants to tell her mother. And sometimes she'll hint to the mother, and the mother acts real stupid. Won't even listen to your own daughter because you don't want to mess up what's going on with your husband or with the stepfather of your daughter. And I'm telling you women that when you get you a man, you better check him out real careful. Because if he don't love your children, don't waste a damn moment with him. You didn't hear me. And you better make sure that when he loves you, he's not looking over your shoulder at your budding daughter. Oh, I know it. I'm just as right on it as I can be. Now, what happens to a daughter who's molested by her father? Let me tell you what happens to her. What is done is the murder of this child in the nature of her as a woman. She can't console another man fully, honestly, and completely unless God heals her. That's why incest is punishable by death. You mean my husband? Yeah, kill him. Yeah. Because he's a killer. He just murdered your daughter. You don't see her crying in the night. You don't know her pain and her anguish. She's growing up, but she can never relate to a man properly because her father been there before any man. And her father is her example of what a man is. And her father killed in her what a man is. And so they go out in the street and they become prostitutes. Yeah. Incest is terrible. And I'm saying to any father in here that's doing this, brother, look, get yourself together and leave your child alone. Please, don't do that. To rape a woman is a crime of extraordinary sensitivity in the heart and mind of God. In the world of Islam, when you rape a woman, we don't feed you in no jail.
No, 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 no.
In the world of Islam, you rape, and we know you did it, after prayer on Friday, we bring you out. It ain't behind the scenes, it's all in the public. Tie your hand behind your back, and that's the closest we come to pork chop.
You know, Muslims don't eat no pork chop. But that's the closest we come to a pork chop.
Because a black man come out with a sword, arms powerful, and kneel you down and poke you in your side. And you stiffen up, chop, poke, chop. No more rapists. Gone. And everybody says, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, meaning God is great.
One more rapist gone.
When a woman is raped, the only process to heal her is the process that begins with the murder of her rapist. Now, you're not applauding real strong.
But when you rape a woman, you've already murdered her. You murdered her in the nature in which she's created, and it's difficult for her to give quiet and peace of mind to any man from that point on. Only God can heal that woman. And so while there's not a lot of approval of that, nevertheless, I'm telling the pastors and the leaders, there'll never be love in our community until we agree to do right by one another. For it is only righteousness that produces love. It is evil that produces hatred. And right now, there's so much hatred in the black community of us, for us, because of the way we treat each other. And so, brothers and sisters, this teaching tonight, simple as it is, in it are solutions. In conclusion, if the nature of man and woman is awakened and death is removed from being our rider and truth and God directs our path, then love will abide among us and unity will come from that love. Then we can pool our resources and build an economic base to provide jobs, security, and peace in our own community. It does not start with white people. Please don't move just yet. Please. I'm just about finished. Please don't. I'm almost right there. Would you be so kind as to hang in there one more minute? Jobs and security will come to us as a people. It starts with us. I want you to back me as I appeal to the government to give black people what the government owes us. Listen, this is my conclusion, but hang in there and hear this. The government owes every one of you something. And you have not collected. We have not collected. Did you know that the Japanese Americans are getting billions of dollars in reparations because they were put in a concentration camp for 4 years, their property confiscated,
and America says, we treated them wrong, we were wrong, we got to pay them reparations. The West Germans are paying reparations to the government and people of Israel in recognition of a wrong done to the Jews. The East Germans, in order to unite with West Germany, had to agree that they were wrong in their mistreatment of the Jews. And they issued a formal apology asking all the Jews in the world and the Jews of Israel in particular to forgive them, not only for the atrocities done during the rule of Hitler, but for the official policies of the government against the Jewish state and people since 1945. And they said they will do all in their power, monetarily and physically, to do what is necessary to repair the mental damage as well as the physical damage of what their wicked policies and programs brought about for the Jews. Isn't that a marvel in modern politics that a government would say that openly and now follow through? Gorbachev admitted to the Polish people that 15,000 Polish soldiers were killed by the Russians and buried in a mass grave, and the Poles say, we demand reparations. I ask you, if we are to be paid what is owed us, what do you think the bill would be? Let's add it up. Let's add it up and go home. The Bible says, a life for a life, a tooth for a tooth, an eye for an eye. What is your life worth? W.E.B. Du Bois said, in the middle passage coming from Africa to America, we lost in the neighborhood of 100 million lives. That's some Holocaust, isn't it? Add it up. 100 million lives. When we got to America, those that made it, we had our culture, our religion, our name, our God, our history, our flag. We had everything that goes for a nation. We were not jungle bunnies. We had built civilization while the white man was crawling in the caves and hillsides of Europe. But what did the old slave master do? He made it brothers with sisters. Yes. Fathers with daughters, mothers with sons. He didn't care nothing about family structure. He broke it right then and there to produce babies. After the babies were produced, he separated the parents from the children. Then he killed the parents and reared the children, making them think they were Negroes, colored people, coon, shine, Hambone, that they lived in Africa and never contributed anything to civilization. This means that you have eyes, but you can't see. You got ears, but you can't hear. You got tongue, but you can't speak. You got arms, but they don't work a bill for you. Why? Because of a crime committed back there 430 years ago. Add it up. Add it up. 300 years we worked from can't see morning to can't see night, working to build the economy of the South. Is that right? We never got one day's pay. I say again, we didn't work for a week, we didn't work for a month, we didn't work for a year, but for 300 long years, we worked for white people for no pay. Add it up. In 1775, when George Washington and the boys
wanted to gain their freedom from the crown of England. It was a black man, Crispus Attucks, and other black men with him that joined with America to fight against Britain. And America got her independence, and we got nothing. Add it up. Add it up. She wrote a constitution, had slaves, and legislated us out of humanity in the cardinal document of the nation, the foundation of law. We were three-fifths of a human being. Add it up. When she said, we're in trouble, our union is breaking apart. North against South, South against North. The black soldiers joined the Army of the North, and black soldiers were used to fight for the South. Did you hear me? Over 400,000 black soldiers, and the black ones in the North had a vendetta against the Southern plantation. And because of you and your father, Abraham Lincoln, and the white boys of the North were able to conquer the South and preserve the Union. It was black soldiers that fought harder than white soldiers. It was black soldiers dying at Gettysburg, dying in Virginia, dying in the colonies, that made America whole again. And then it was the black soldiers in the South that preserved the integrity of the victory. And it was the blacks that caused the whites to come back into the Union. You made America. You. Add it up. But they didn't give us nothing. After the Civil War, black folk went into Congress. Black folk became senators. Black folk became governor. Black folk got up into politics, but white folk didn't like it. So then came the Ku Klux Klan and the Knight Riders. And they turned all blacks out of government, robbed us of representation. Yeah, add it up. 300 years, it didn't allow us to read and write. Deprived us of knowledge. Then the Christian white folk said it was not incompatible for us to be slaves and Christians. So around 1740, they allowed us to build the black church. But they didn't want us to preach the full gospel. They wanted us to preach, slave, obey your master. And if I smite you on your right cheek, turn to me the other. If I take your coat, give me your pants. If I ask you to go 1 mile, go two. Stay right there, preacher. Don't get too happy. Don't read no Old Testament about no Moses, lest you get the idea of revolution. So the black church became an expression of what white folk wanted black folk to have in religion. But some black pastors begin to read the Old Testament. They begin to read about Moses standing up against Pharaoh. And thus Nat Turner rose up. But he was betrayed by Uncle Tom black people. Denmark Vesey rose up. And he was betrayed by Uncle Tom black people. And they killed Nat Turner and they killed those with him, all because they wanted to have some freedom. I say, add it up. We helped America in the War of 1812. We helped America in the Spanish-American War. We helped America steal Texas, steal New Mexico, Arizona, and California from the Mexicans. They didn't offer us nothing. Add it up. The Buffalo Soldier marched with white folk. Help him kill the Indians. Mine messed up.
We helped the white man conquer the territories. But after he got it all, he didn't offer us nothing. I say, add it up. In the early 1900s, the Kaiser rose up in Germany. Here's Germany again. And World War I started. The black soldier said, let me join. The black sailor said, let me join. White folks said, we don't want niggers in the army. We don't want niggers in the Navy. But finally, they let us in, but they didn't want us. Learning how to navigate ships, just swab the deck, cook the food. But there we were. White folk won World War I, crushed Germany, divided up the German Empire among the other European thieves. And then Hitler rose to power. And as Hitler rose to power and began moving in Germany and formed an axis with Mussolini and Hirohito and Tojo, then the Japanese struck Pearl Harbor December 7, 1941, because Japan then was becoming an economic power. And America put the squeeze on Japan. So Japan felt that the only way out was to attack America and make a decisive blow. So they planned. They fixed their flag and they made it the flag of the rising sun. Meaning what? As the day sun is setting on the Western world, a new sun is rising in the world of the dark man. So Japan struck December 7, 1941, and you enlisted. Dory Miller was just a man on a ship. And when the white boys was running for cover, Dory Miller had never been trained on a gun. But Dory jumped up on the gun and began shooting down Japanese Zeros. He was more American than the American, more patriotic than the patriots, more white than the white. Add it up. We joined the army and we left our body in the Philippines, in the Solomon Islands, in Corregidor, Bataan, Iwo Jima. We left our body in the theaters of the Pacific. When they were fighting Hitler, we left our body in North Africa. And in the North African theater, we went from there to Sicily. Then from Sicily to Naples and Palermo, then we conquered Rome. But then the soldiers came across from England to Normandy Beach, and the black soldiers were there. They were there in Antwerp, Holland. They were there in Paris. They were there in Belgium. They were there in Germany. And we left our bodies all over the world fighting for white people. But when the war was over and they came back home, thinking that we would get some measure of justice, the white man said, nigger, get back in your place. They took our money and rebuilt Germany. Took our money, rebuilt Japan. Now Germany's a world power. Japan is a world power. And you dying on the streets of Dallas with no job, I say, add it up. Add it up. Look. We produce Marcus Garvey. And they lied on Marcus Garvey. Brought him into court on trumped up charges. Put him in prison. Deported him and broke his movement. Add it up. We produced W.E.B. Du Bois, one of the greatest black scholars to ever rise among us. E.B. Du Bois, who fought against Booker T. E.B. Du Bois, who fought against Marcus G.
But E.B. Du Bois kept on growing. And before you know it, white folk didn't like E.B. Du Bois. And he died in Ghana, developing the history and the accomplishments of black people to the rise of civilized people. Gone. Paul Robeson, our giant, our scholar, our great actor and singer, went to Europe and was loved throughout the white world. But because he became infected with the idea of freedom, he came back to America and the government told us he was a filthy communist. The same government that's sitting down rubbing noses with Gorbachev today. The same government that says it's all right to lay down with communists today made us stone Paul Robeson. So he died in Philadelphia a broken man because he loved his people. He worked for his people and his people sold him out. Adam Clayton Powell, one of the greatest legislators of all time, a black man, a preacher, an arrogant man who stood proud for black people. He was kind of highbrow. Looked like he made a pass if he wanted to get around. But the brother let everybody know he was black. He got so powerful in the Congress, he was third in rank, next to the Speaker of the House, next to the Majority Whip. There was Adam Clayton Powell moving up. They got a bag woman in Harlem, and they worked on Adam Powell till they got him out of Congress, broke his seniority. He won an election and went back, but he was no more the Adam that once was. They did that to him. And then in the 50s, Rosa Parks says she decided to sit down to help us to stand up. And after Rosa stood up, Martin King was born. But while Martin was there, there was Elijah Muhammad on the other side. Elijah Muhammad said, no, don't integrate into the white man. His time of judgment has come. It's time for the black man to be separated to build a nation of his own. The FBI was upset at Martin, and they were upset at Elijah. Elijah developed a student. His name was Malcolm X. And Malcolm X only went to the eighth grade of school because in the eighth grade, Malcolm wanted to be a lawyer. But they told Malcolm, you'd make a good carpenter. So Malcolm left school and became a hustler and a pimp and a dope seller and a dope user. And after armed robbery, sentenced to 7 or 15 years in the penitentiary, he heard the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and he began to read everything in the prison library, starting with the dictionary. He came out after 7 years, 7 months, and 7 days, and he began to electrify the masses of black people, calling the white man a devil, talking about the end of the white man's world. Here was a new reality, Mr. X. Why was he Mr. X? Because he said that the name that you wear is not your name. The name that you proudly hold is not your name. That's the name of your former slave masters and their children. So you are Johnson, you are Jones, you are Brown, McGillicuddy, Green, White, Overstreet, Underbrook, Muddy Water, Clearwater, Washington, Lincoln, Jefferson, Johnson. All these other names of white people have nothing to do with you. Look at you, can't speak your own mother tongue, but you can parlez-vous français aujourd'hui. You can comment parlez-vous. You can como esta usted. You can sprechen Sie Deutsch. But you don't know one word of your own mother tongue because mother gone, father gone, a motherless nation sees a hard time. I say, add it up. And when you add it all up, a government that killed our leaders, a government
moment spent $42 million to get Mayor Barry. Government spent money to knock down our strong politician. Yes, Mayor Barry was wrong. We can't make wrong right. But for 12 years, spending $40 to $42 million of your money to trap your brother, because they don't want to see a black man in power in Washington, D.C. Add it up. Add up the fact that they put you in the army and sent you to die in Panama, sent you to die in Grenada, and maybe soon will send you to die in Africa or in Cuba. Add it up. And here we are penniless, looking to the welfare to give us a check, when if the government just gave us what they owe us, we would never need to ask them for another dime again. Well, what do they owe us for 100 million lives in the Middle Passage, for nearly 20 million lives since we've been here, for the murder, the wanton murder of the fruit of our womb under their instigation? If God said a life for a life, then if you look at the population of America, a little over 220 million people, 20 million of them Hispanic, 40 million of them black, that's 60 million right there. So 160 million and 60 million is 220 million. So if you add up a life for a life, then the whole of white America is sentenced to death. If you add it up. You didn't hear me. If God will take a life for a life, don't tell me because I'm black my life don't have no value. He who gave life determined value, not white folk. So this whole generation has death hanging over its head. White folk, I'm telling you, death is hanging over your head. Your parents have set a table of death for you to sit down at. You're not guilty, present generation of whites, for what your fathers have done, but you benefit. You are the beneficiaries of the robbery. You are the beneficiaries of the destruction. You are the beneficiaries of everything that has happened to us. And so unless you, the present generation of whites, will be like the West Germans and say to black people, we offer you an apology. I ask all black people in America and throughout the world to accept our humble apology for being wicked demons, devils, beasts in our mistreatment of black people. And I ask your forgiveness for working you for 300 years for nothing, making you fight in our wars and not giving you nothing. I ask your forgiveness for killing your leaders and for planning right now to kill Farrakhan, the Nation of Islam, and an attack on the whole black community under the guise of drugs, gangs, and violence. Don't you think that they're not planning this, brother? You preachers, it's on you. It's in the book. Pharaoh said, the children of Israel are multiplying. Let us deal wisely with them, lest in their multiplication they join on to an enemy of ours and come against us. So they hatched a plan to kill all boy babies of the children of Israel. That's not in the scripture for conjecture. That's talking about you. And it's not an accident that 25% of our youth are either in prison, on parole, or under some kind of observation by the authorities. It is not an accident that infant mortality is killing another whole generation of us. It is not an accident that crack is in your community. You don't make no damn crack. These are wise chemical demons putting crack in your community. It is no accident that black women, black men are being infected with AIDS. It is not an accident. They have prescribed death for us, and God has prescribed death for them. So I say to America, come against me if you want to. I'm not running from you. I'm running to you. Because I know that the power of heaven is on my side. And I know that if God were not with me, I would have been dead a long time ago. But God is with me. And I put my trust in God. And I say, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. It is he who restored my soul and leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk in the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for God is with me and with you and with us. Thank you for listening, and may Allah bless you as I greet you in peace. Assalamu alaikum. Brothers and sisters, let's have prayer. Let's have prayer and go. I love you. Can I ask you a question? How many of you that are here tonight believe that what you heard taught, that it is the truth and is good for us as a people? My last question is this. Look, brothers and sisters, whenever you go and hear somebody speak, as they are speaking to you, there's something else happening. Not only are they speaking to you, there's an inner voice that is the voice of God himself talking with you about what you're hearing from that man. And maybe tonight, some of you that heard me say, that is the truth, and that's what I've been looking for all the days of my life. And I want to stand with Brother Farrakhan, and I want to unite with him and help him to build and reform and transform the lives of our people. I would like to know if any of you in this audience were so touched by a bigger power than me who speaks and you who listen, but the power of the God that you know and believe is the Lord of all creation. If that God touched you in some way to make you see that I'm not a racist, I'm not a bigot, I'm not a hater, I'm not an anti-Semite, I'm your brother, and I'm standing in America for you and for our people and for all oppressed people. How many of you would be willing to unite with me and become a part of a movement to free black people in America and all over the world? Would you raise your hands? Would you say these words with me? I bear witness that there is but one God, and his proper name is Allah. I bear witness to Moses and the Old Testament. I bear witness to Jesus and the New Testament. I bear witness to Prophet Muhammad and the Holy Quran. I bear witness that Muhammad is the messenger of God. With that declaration, no, you don't have to repeat that. With that declaration, you have risen above all denomination.
that divides us. We have risen above all expressions of faith that divide us. All names of God are good. And you can sum all of those names up in one name, Allah. That means all of the attributes of God in their perfected degree are summed up in that name. And so, my dear brothers and sisters, with that declaration, you are what we would call Muslim, and it only means one who submits to do the will of God. Well, wait a minute. You say, well, I'm a Christian. Me too. Well, how are you a Christian, Farrakhan? Because to be a Christian means to be crystallized into oneness with God following the example of Jesus Christ. And no one of us can be a Muslim except we believe in Jesus and believe in him as the perfect example of the scriptures of the Torah and the gospel that he brought. That's our way. So from this day forward, if you're a Baptist, don't say I'm a Baptist to the man that's a Methodist and start fighting with him over denomination. Because Jesus never said, I'm a Baptist, I'm a Methodist, I'm an Episcopalian, I'm a Congregationalist, I'm a Lutheran, I'm a Jehovah's Witness. He didn't say none of that, did he? He said, not my will be done, thy will be done. So as a family, let's go out of here tonight resolved that we will be family. When you see each other, smile. If there's anything you can do to help each other, go out of your way to do it. Be kind to each other. And before you know it, a new spirit will rise in Dallas. And on that new spirit, we will build a new reality. Let us pray. And I will pray a part of this prayer in Arabic and a part in English. And if you would you hold the hands of each other? I know this is different as a Muslim. We pray in the manner that we see our Muslim brothers there with their dua. But hold each other's hands for a moment. You can hold hands, brothers. All right. With your heads slightly bowed.
قل أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا صراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, all praise is due to Allah, the Lord of the worlds, the Beneficent, the Merciful, Master of the Day of Judgment. Thee alone do we worship, and to thee alone do we beseech for help. Guide us on the right path, the path of those upon whom you have bestowed favors, not of those upon whom wrath is brought down, nor of those who go astray. O Allah, we thank you for this meeting this evening. We thank you for all those who are present and those who wanted to come, but were not able to come. We ask that as we leave here, that the spirit of death be removed from our minds, and that we gain a new respect for the life that you and only you could give, and that we commit ourselves never again to take the lives of one another
and kill no one whom God has not ordered to be killed, and take no life outside of the law of justice. As we leave this place, help us to leave knowing that we are brothers and sisters. And O Allah, we beg you to revive the life of the male and crown his head with knowledge and wisdom, that he may be the maintainer of women. And we ask that you resurrect the nature of our women and crown them with wisdom and knowledge, that they may help us to lay the foundation of a better world for those that come after us and all those of other races who will come out from under death and recognize that the color of their skin is not the measure of the person, but only their obedience to your will and carrying out the duty of righteousness is what makes one of us superior to the other. Bless all of the ministers who are present, the imams, the teachers of our people who are present, and inspire them to teach your will. And all the city councilmen and politicians, bless them and strengthen them that as they go into the halls ruled by death, that they be not overcome by the power of the world. For you have said, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And all that are called by your name, you will give us power to overcome. Help us to overcome the force of death, that we may say, O grave, where is thy victory? O death, where is thy sting? Yes, and now go with us as we depart and take us safely home to our loved ones and to our places of abode. Yes, we ask this of you in your name, bearing witness that there is nothing deserving of worship beside you, and bearing witness to Moses, Jesus, Muhammad, and all the prophets, that they are your chosen servants, and we desire to follow in their footsteps to you. Amen.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. Those of you who want the tape of tonight's lecture or the videotape, it is high-speed duplicating right now. If you have the time to wait, you can get it. If you don't have the time, look in your program and you will see it right there. For a copy of tonight's tape, right on the bottom of the last page, call that number and we'll make sure you get tonight's tape. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.